This is TWiT.
Congress introduced not one, not two, not three, not four, but five regulating bills regulating big technology a little less than a week ago. Alex, of course, this is right up your alley. The bills are mostly antitrust. You actually break them all down, which is nice. Bill 1, the American Innovation and Choice Online Act, which is the AIACOA. IACOA.
There are also sorts of fun acronyms for these.
Usually they have good acronyms. That one's not so good. The Ending Platform Monopolies. These were all introduced in the House of Representatives. That's Bill 2. 3 is Augmenting Compatibility and Competition by Enabling Service Switching Act. This is the only one that I kind of really think is a good idea. It's the Interoperability Act, essentially saying that data should be portable. The Merger Filing Fee Modernization Act of 2021. This is the one that everybody says will probably become law. The Senate even will probably pass this. All it is another tax. If you file for a merger, there's the new higher fees will pay for regulation. That's, I think, Elizabeth Warren's bill.
Yeah. And the Senate has already passed
it. That's so right. They passed it. Now the House is
on a clear path.
Yeah. But the rest of them, probably not. Bill 5, Platform Competition and Opportunity Act. Mm-hmm. So Alex did a great job, all five of them in one spot, if you want to read them. But what is your take on these? Besides the additional fee for mergers, does any of them have a chance?
Well, I've long said that there's very little chance that big tech is going to actually be reined in.
Yeah.
And that they won't be broken up. They won't face serious legislation. Congress doesn't know what it's doing. The regulators are weak. I am starting to change my tune a little bit. Oh. I'm not saying that these will necessarily be passed, but I'm saying there is a better chance of these things being passed into law and signed by Joe Biden than I think we could have anticipated in the past. The fact that Lina Khan is running the FTC, which I know we're about to get to, and the fact that these bills have bipartisan support, some of the exact same bills have been introduced in the House, passed in the Senate, have bipartisan support in the House, and the wild card is Rupert Murdoch, who is no friend to big tech, is pushing Republican lawmakers to support these bills. And you've seen Tucker Carlson go after those who haven't. And so there, that way you can have anti-big tech Democrats coming together with Republicans who already don't like big tech because of the censorship claims. And then you have Rupert Murdoch, who doesn't like them because of the business realities. Everybody comes together in one big happy family and actually can cause some damage here. So the smart money would say that there's not a great chance that four of the five outside of the merger money will be passed. I would say if you had like to bet on it, there's a much better chance that this stuff will go through now than there was, you know, a couple of years ago when senators were asking Mark Zuckerberg how to send email through WhatsApp.
Right. And of course, the right has one reason they want to regulate big tech, primarily stemming from Facebook and Twitter's banning of the President Trump. The left has another reason. It's more antitrust. It's because traditionally Republicans are pro-big business, right?
Right, yeah. And this really doesn't touch on the censorship issue that the right is so concerned about. Three out of the five bills here, I admit, when I first read them, it gave me the Canned Spam Act vibe where, okay, it sounds good, but they're not going to really enforce this. It's going to be impossible to actually do anything with it. But the fact that they've picked Khan to head up that office, and you could essentially take three out of the five bills from her paper, the one that she published on platforms and commerce that she did for the Columbia Law Review.
Lina Khan is the new chairman of the FTC, youngest ever, 32 years old, and is very well known for her anti-big tech writings.
And this is not a coincidence. They're essentially giving her the ammunition she needs to go after them. So if she had just taken over, it would have been an uphill battle. If the bills were standalone, it would have been an uphill battle. But you have a commissioner who now has laws.
It's all kind of lining up.
There you go.
Alex, you'd call one of them a dumb rocket, not a well-guided missile. And in particular, one of the five bills you don't like is the bill that would prevent, which actually on the face of it seems reasonable, prevent companies from acquiring potential competitors like Facebook did with Instagram and WhatsApp to eliminate competitors in the marketplace. But you say that, and I think you make a good point here, that's going to hurt innovation, because one of the reasons people start companies is so that they'll be acquired by a big tech company like Google, Facebook, Amazon, or Apple.
Well, it's not so much that the end goal is to get acquired by big tech. I think anyone who starts a company really hopes that they'll IPO and become the next one of these companies. But most startups don't succeed. And so you want to have a safety net there just in case you don't reach IPO level. You don't want to end up capitulating and getting bought by a small company for a low amount of money or having to fold your operation. And these five big tech companies have made some big acquisitions for companies that aren't ready to go public, but do create some real value. And so it's not as much as like what's going to happen if they stop the acquisitions today. It's how does that change the incentives for startup founders? Because I think startup founders are pretty smart. They think about where they're going before they get there. And if they see that their predecessors aren't able to have impressive exits if they can't IPO, they might change their calculation about whether they want to start their company in the first place. And if we do have less companies starting in the country, we're going to end up having, as you mentioned, less innovation. And so I think that's a really big deal.
You also make an excellent point, and we have a very good example of that. If companies are prohibited from acquiring other companies, Facebook did get Instagram and WhatsApp, but they wanted Snapchat, and Snapchat said no, then what they'll do is one of two things. They'll either create a competitive clone, which is what Facebook did to Snapchat, and try to put it out of the business that way. That might, you might argue, well, that's good because there'll be competition now. Or they acquire, they acqui-hire the people from that company. Right. They hire away all the good talent and then, in effect, hollow the company out from the inside. Neither of which outcome really is ideal. I think it's probably better for Facebook to clone Snapchat than it is for them to buy it, though. So
I think there's a good lens here is to look at it through the eyes of Lina Khan, because her thing and the way she's looking at monopolies and antitrust is not just, oh, you're big, therefore you're a monopoly. She's looking specifically at platforming. So if you use your platform to then decrease competition, even if it keeps prices down, she believes that's still anti-competitive. So what she's opening the door for is you can be the platform, but you have to be a common carrier. You can have acquisitions, but you can't have acquisitions if you also run the platform. I think that's actually a good balance, because I agree. I think that it can stop innovation if people don't know if they're going to be able to recoup their initial investment because they can't get all the way through with the startup. But you can have that without allowing the company to be bought by the dominant platform, by the Amazon, the Microsoft, the Apple. I'd like to give this a try.
Well, don't we have, just to push back on this a little bit, don't we have regulatory agencies for a reason? I mean, we put Lina Khan in charge of the agency that evaluates these mergers and acquisitions. And now we're going to write a law that says the companies that she's focused on can't acquire at all. Like, I thought we had faith in this person to actually run an agency in a competent way, which it hasn't been up until this point. It hasn't had the resources or the staffing or the ambition. Now we have Lina Khan in there, and we're going to write a law that's going to take away the agency's ability to evaluate these
that's a good point.
Mergers. Do it one by one. Do it on a case-by-case basis. You never know what's going to happen if you write what I called it a dumb rocket, because it's so broad that there could be a ton of collateral damage. And ultimately, it's Congress saying we want to, prevent we're going to have these companies around for a long time. We're going to have companies that meet these definitions that that Congress put forward in the paper for a long time. And so I just find it a little bit ridiculous to say they can't acquire. I mean, it's just, that's not how a market works. I thought these things were supposed to promote competition. And at the end of the day, I think this really inhibits it.
Now, Alex, I want to ask about that, because my understanding was these are more soft touch. So the FTC would still be doing that evaluation, right? I mean, they would be the ones who could look at a potential deal and say, no, this runs afoul of that law, or it doesn't. Or does this completely take it away from the FTC? I didn't read that part.
Look, it doesn't take it away completely. But when you look at the law, the prohibition on acquisitions is so broad that it would be really difficult for these companies to make the case that they should be able to acquire. I mean, basically, it says, you can't acquire something that's going to enhance your service or potentially competes with you. What's left? I mean, I really don't know, especially look at the companies, the size that they are and the amount of different things that they do. So honestly, just, I mean, we have an FTC to approve these things for a reason. So and it's just going to lead to all these downstream bad effects. And I mean, just last thing about the law, it starts not with the exceptions, but with the broad prohibition. You can't make acquisitions unless, right? As opposed to these are potentially the type of acquisitions you can't make, leaving the rest open. So it's so broad. I don't know. Look, I think that we have a package of five bills, as Leo mentioned at the top. Some are going to have some really good ideas. I think some have great ideas. I think funding the regulators is extremely smart. I've been calling for it for a while in big technology. Some of the other ideas talked about are also pretty good, but you're also going to have some, you know, pretty dumb and bad ideas. And I happen to think this is one. I'm welcome disagreement, but I just don't see the need to do what Congress is outlining in this one.
That's fair. That's fair.
Also, the nature of this is that even if the House passes all five, well, yeah, all four, because the fifth one, if the House passes, it's done.
But there's something in the way.
It has to not only get through the Senate, but it also has to get through reconciliation. Mm-hmm. Presumably, the Senate's going to have some other opinions about this. This is how the sausage is made. You propose something, you negotiate, and maybe you come to a better law down the at the end of the
line. I see the Senate suddenly wanting to insert language along with these bills to address the censorship item.
I think at some point, though, also. Yeah. Republicans have to stand up for what they've said all along, which is we believe in business and we believe in less regulation. This is not less regulation. No. This is more regulation. This is contrary to what Republicans have said for, you know, since 1920. So
it is remarkable how Republicans and Democrats are so in sync on this. I mean, you look at these
for different reasons, yet in sync. Yeah,
I think the 2016 election turned them all against big tech. Right, the Democrats said you did Trump, and then they evolved that into you're anti-competitive, and the Republicans said you're censoring conservative voices, and they said what authority do we have to take on these companies, and they evolved that into competition. And then you have a hearing where you have Amy Klobuchar and Josh Hawley, who would never agree with each other on anything.
Yeah.
Giving each other time and riffing off of each other's points.
That scares the hell out of me, to be honest with you.
Yeah, so I say 2017, 2018, it didn't seem like anything was going to happen. But, you know, the government works in really interesting ways. And once you get something written down on paper, which we have right now, you never know where it's going to go. And so I've given up the never going to happen perspective. Could happen.
It is unpredictable.
And you watch the way these folks talk. And even Joe Biden is on board with a lot of this stuff.
Well, he appointed Tim Wu to his...
Tim Wu.
Yeah, I mean, clearly the Biden administration is all in on regulating big tech.
Yeah.
Let's not forget, Europe is also all in on regulating big tech. So I could see why Jeff Bezos retired. it's not a good time.
I think the issue is both the Republicans and the Democrats agree on regulating big tech, but they don't want the other side to take a win for regulating
Nor
big tech.
Nor do they really agree on the best on ways why, to do it. Yeah, exactly. Why and what but, the best ways are.
You know, our politics has become so much about punishing your enemies as opposed to supporting your causes. And Leo, when you talk about the Republican support for free markets, that's all I thought about was like, you know, they're mad enough that maybe this is where they end up going.
Yeah.
So Bezos, I mean, I think this past week I did a tweet talking about how, you know, once he heard Lina Khan was going to be the FTC commissioner, he said, okay, space doesn't really sound so bad.
Well, you saw the petition that Jeff Bezos stay in space once he gets there. I think there's something like 30 or 40,000 signatures. I don't know how exactly he would do it, but...
Yeah, he's only going to be there for 3 minutes. Yeah, so sorry to disappoint everyone. He's coming back.
He's coming back. So is Richard Branson. Well, if all goes well, anyway. Who's going to be the person who stands up and says, yeah, they banned Trump, but you know what? What would this pandemic have been like without big tech making it possible for us to go to school, for many of us to stay working? This pandemic would have been a lot worse without big tech. And let's not forget the technology, mRNA, that's given us the vaccine. It's so easy to make an enemy out of tech. But I think there's also, I want to defend it a little bit because there's a consequence to this. We get a lot of benefits out of this. You know, one of the debates we've been talking about over the last few weeks is Amazon's sidewalk. Which, you know, if it came from anybody but Amazon, people might not have been so negative about it. It is, I think, Amazon's attempt to do something for the public good. But because it came out of Amazon and because they had it on by default, I think people are going to, it's going to be a non-starter. Have you talked at all, Nicholas, about Sidewalk and with your Consumer Reports audience, and what is your recommendation to them?
I have not written about Sidewalk, but I will want to sort of tag on to what you just said. And I sort of personally agree. I've been covering, technology for 15 years now. I grew up reading like Sound and Vision magazine and things like that. All this stuff was like always fun and exciting and interesting to me. So I do understand people's concerns with, but like big tech, like I honestly didn't even recognize it. That's like, oh, that's like big tobacco until like months ago.
It is.
And I'm like, people really hate these companies that, in you know, they've really improved our lives. And I get the concerns, and I understand, you know, especially with the antitrust stuff and consumers having choice in the marketplace. But, you know, personally, I don't know. I like Amazon. I use it all the time. a lot of these companies have immeasurably improved my life. And you know, I speak to readers all the time, and they're, you know, they agree. I remember a couple of years ago, I was doing a big Facebook story and talking to folks like, oh, how to use Facebook. And to a person, they were like, oh, I use it to share, you know, baby photos and to, you know, like grandma's, funny posts. And it's like, maybe people are naive. Maybe people don't see the harm. But like for the average person, which is my audience and the kind of, you know, the headspace that I kind of live in most of the time nowadays, this stuff seems maybe not academic, but like, a very different vibe, I think, to what sort of the average person feels.
It's,
maybe I'm wrong. I don't know.
No, it's the world we live in where you can get people riled up. They ban the president on Facebook at the same time as they go, but I'm going to use it to say Happy Father's Day. I love it.
Exactly.
And I think people do actually love Google, Facebook, Amazon, Apple. They do love it. And they use it. Tomorrow is Prime Day. Tomorrow and Tuesday are Prime Days. They're going to have huge amounts of traffic, huge amounts of people using Amazon at the same time as people saying, but I don't, which that's part of the Sidewalk argument that gets me, because the people who are turning off Sidewalk, the only way you could turn off Sidewalk is if you have Amazon Echoes in your house or Ring doorbells in your house. You're already giving Amazon images and sound and everything else. And you're worried about Sidewalk? I mean, it doesn't make sense to me.
I was with my parents in Las Vegas, and they live in a semi-retirement
community. It's a little schizophrenic.
It's very schizophrenic. They were with groups of friends, and they all started talking about how much they hated Amazon, and they would never buy anything from Amazon. But they've got Ring video doorbells. They do pill packs.
Pill packs.
They've got the Amazon Echoes in the house. So they don't quite understand exactly how much that company reaches.
Maybe that's part of the problem, is that big tech is so pervasive now.
Right.
You cannot escape it. We've seen articles years ago, even from the New York Times, was it Kevin Roos who said, or Taylor Lorenz, somebody said, I'm not going to use any of the big five. And she basically couldn't use anything.
That was Cash Hill.
Cash Hill. Yeah. Without Google, Amazon, every site is hosted by Amazon or Google. We live in big tech. We're immersed in it.
But it's hard to imagine
surgery that's going to leave the patient alive and well.
Aren't we getting to the issue here, which is that these companies, I think many of us agree, are a net positive to society.
Yes.
But, and I'm going to steal this from Scott Galloway. He said this before. The key word is net, right? So there's also a ton of things that they do that are a little bit, past the line. And so I don't think, even though that they're, you know, I appreciate all five of these companies. I'm an Amazon Prime member. I'm a Facebook, you know, daily or weekly active user. I use the rest. But we should still not give up on the fact that some of the stuff that they're doing, you know, is potentially anti-competitive and might need to be reined in. And if you look specifically at, I've already talked about my opposition to this prohibition of acquisitions. But if you look specifically at David Cicilline's bill, I don't like the whole thing. But the fact that it says, if you're a company like Amazon or Google, you cannot take data from third parties that are using your services and then use that to enhance your services, I think that's pretty good. Because what you end up having is a number of small and medium-sized businesses, whether they're software providers or whether they're merchants that are selling on Amazon, they end up losing out on potential market opportunity because they're forced to go through Amazon or a Google to reach the people that are going to end up using their products or buying their services. And they have this reality where Amazon and Google are taking their business secrets away that they get by nature of the fact they have to work on their platforms and using it to make their products great and crowd out the competitors. And I think if you want to have a true competitive market economy, you can't have that happen, because online, you really only want to have one search engine. You really only want to have one e-commerce platform, because, you know, once they become better than all the rest, why use anything else? So that's why I think we're seeing a moment where, you know, from if you take it in the good faith position, that's why I think you're seeing a moment where we're trying to rein these companies in a little bit, because their excesses are, leading to the fact that others can't grow. So it's not that they're all bad. You know, there are some people who are out there who's like, these companies can't do anything good. But we should make sure that when we think about the net, we try to decrease as much negative as possible and unlock as much good.